Welcome back, everyone. Today I will be speaking about anatomy of the spinal cord. This is very important because on the basis of this particular webinar, we will go to very important topics, that is the anatomy of the pyramidal tracts, anatomy of the dorsal columns, anatomy of the spinothalamic tract, and this will lead to help us in localization of spinal cord pathology and spinal cord injury. Unless you don't know the anatomy of these important tracts within our spinal cord, you will neither be able to understand the clinical manifestations, nor will you be able to understand the MRI and imaging of the spinal cord. So let us go slow. In this webinar, I will introduce you to very important concepts of the spinal cord, which are clinically important. Okay, and before I proceed further, let me know, are you able to hear me clear? Once I get a message that my audio is clear, I will go further. Just let me know if my audio is clear. Am I audible? I'm not sure, am I audible or not? Just let me know if I'm audible or not. Okay. Yeah, one thing, if I am not audible at any point of time, message me on WhatsApp. Because I will keep my WhatsApp on. So if I'm not audible, kindly message me on the WhatsApp. So let's go into our topic. Yeah, if you have any problem, try to message me on WhatsApp. So let us start with the basic concepts of the spinal cord. As you know, the spinal cord extends from the foramen magnum until the coccyx. Am I clear? So every one of you, it's divided into cervical spine, dorsal spine, lumbar spine, sacral, and the coccygeal. So how many segments of spinal cord we have? So how many segments of spinal cord we have? I'm waiting for an answer. Or in other way, how many pairs of spinal nerves we have, right? So we have 31 pairs of spinal nerves. So what you have to remember is there are 5 segments of sacrum and 1 pair of coccygeal nerve, which we frequently forget. Everyone remembers there are 8 pairs of cervical nerves, 12 pairs of thoracic nerves, 5 pair of lumbar nerves, and 5 pairs of sacral nerves. One thing which is important is we have 8 cervical nerves and 7 cervical vertebra. This is very important. So everyone should remember there are 7 cervical vertebrae but 8 cervical nerves. Second concept. So this is the pons and the medulla oblongata, which I have told in my last seminar. So where does the spinal cord start? Where does the spinal cord start? So the demarcation between the medulla oblongata and the spinal cord is at the level of the foramen magnum. So this is the level of foramen magnum. So the structure above the level of foramen magnum is our brainstem. And the lowest part of the brainstem is the medulla oblongata. So where does it end? So it ends at the last coccygeal segment, coccyx. So this is our spinal cord. Okay, today I don't have a pen, so you will have to get adjusted. So when you see the external surface of the spinal cord. Suppose I hold the entire spinal cord in my hand. There are two enlargements. One is known as the cervical enlargement. Second one is the lumbar enlargement. Why is the spinal cord thick at the cervical enlargement? Why is the cord thick at the lumbar enlargement? Why are these enlargements? Enlargement means there is more amount of nervous tissue there. And why is the nervous tissue more in that part? Can anyone guess? I will give a hint. This cervical part supplies the upper limb, hands. So because it has to supply the entire cervical limb through the brachial plexus, this part has more number of neurons, and so this part is large. Similarly, lumbar enlargement will have to supply the lower legs and the perianal sensations and our bladder and bowel. So it contains more number of neurons in the other part of the spinal cord. So this, through the lumbosacral plexus, supplies the lower limb. This, through the brachial plexus, supplies the upper limb. So can anyone guess what is the region of cervical enlargement? Which segments? Yeah, waiting for your answer. So cervical enlargement goes to which segments? Yeah, as usual, because the brachial plexus supplies from C5 to T1, so cervical enlargement also lies from C5 to L1, T1. So this exactly corresponds to our brachial plexus. Okay, and so similarly, can anyone guess for which segments does the lumbar enlargement constitute? The lumbosacral plexus starts from where? So somewhere from L2 to L3 to the sacral nerves and the coccygeal nerves. L1 by L2, L3 to the sacrococcygeal one. So this corresponds to the lumbar segment. What is more important is the concept of conus medullaris, cauda equina, and the phylum terminale. This concept is very important. The next few minutes which I'm telling you, you should very clearly understand what is conus medullaris, you should very clearly understand what is phylum, and you should very clearly understand what is cauda equina. Okay, so from the entire spinal cord, we have the nerve roots coming out. So we have the bilateral nerve roots coming off from each segment. So what I'm drawing now is the nerve roots. So we have the D1, D2, D3, D4, and similarly lumbar, sacral, and all these are the nerve roots. Okay. Similarly, we have the nerve roots coming from the lumbar enlargement and the terminal part of the spinal cord. So these are the nerve roots coming from the terminal part of the spinal cord. So we will understand the concept of these three important structures: conus medullaris, phylum terminale, and the cauda equina. First, what is conus medullaris? The terminal portion of the spinal cord is known as the conus medullaris. So what am I drawing? The terminal part of the spinal cord, the bulbous edge. This is like the nib of ink pen. This terminal part is known as the conus medullaris. So conus medullaris is a part of the spinal cord. Okay. This phylum terminale is a pia arachnoid structure. That is, it is a fibrous band. Phylum terminale is a fibrous band. I will use a different color so it will be very clear. So this blue structure which I am showing is the phylum terminale. This is made up of pia arachnoid and few fibrous structures. This phylum terminale does not contain neural structure. So am I clear? Conus medullaris is the terminal part of the spinal cord. Phylum terminale is a fibrous structure connecting the conus medullaris through the tip of the coccyx. It is a non-neural structure. And what is cauda equina? So let me write cauda equina. So cauda equina. So let us see what is the English meaning of this. So what is cauda? So what is cauda? Cauda is caudal. So caudal is the lowest portion, back portion. So because it is situated the lowest end, it is called the cauda. And what is equina? What is equina's deformity? What is equina? Can anyone answer what is equina? I'm waiting for your answer. Yeah, so equina is in a horse. So what does it mean? Cauda equina is the rear end of the backside of the horse. So how is the backside of a horse? Everyone knows. What is the tail of the horse? Similar, if you recognize this one, if you see this one, it resembles the tail of the horse. So this entire nerve roots, is known as the cauda equina. So conus medullaris is a part of the spinal cord. It's a neural structure. Cauda equina is a neural structure, but it is a bunch of nerve roots. And phylum terminale is a non-neural structure. So let me put one question. If there is an, so suppose there is a compression coming from this side. See my arrow. Okay. So if the compression is coming from this side, so this is compressing the cauda equina. So will the deficit be unilateral or bilateral? Right, because it's coming, it's a part of spinal nerves. We have the right side spinal nerves or the left side spinal nerves. So as the compression comes over here, the cauda equina deficit causes a unilateral symptom. But when the cauda equina is unilateral, but as the compression progresses, it progressively involves more and more nerve roots and it becomes bilateral. So cauda equina causes unilateral neurological deficits, which progress to become bilateral deficits. Suppose this compression is on the conus medullaris. Now, will the symptoms be unilateral or bilateral? I'm waiting for your answer. Right. Because conus medullaris is a midline structure, it's a part of this spinal cord. So deficits of conus medullaris are usually bilateral. Third one, suppose I cut the phylum terminal, what will be the neurological deficits? I'm cutting this phylum terminal. So what neurological deficits can you expect? Fine. So because the phylum terminale is a non-neurological structure, if you cut the phylum terminale, patient will have deficits. So is it clear? So conus medullaris causes bilateral deficits. Cauda equina causes unilateral deficits. Yeah. So cauda equina causes unilateral deficits, which progress to become bilateral deficits. And the phylum terminale injury doesn't cause neurological deficits. Similar, one more question. Suppose one condition, when is the bladder and bowel involvement more common? Early bowel and bladder involvement is seen is lesions of conus medullaris or caudae equina or phylum. Yeah, as Dr. Shravani has said, there are no neurological deficits in phylum terminal injury. Yeah, loss and bowel of bladder, as Dr. Ashwini was saying, is it early in conus medullaris injury or caudae equina injury or phylum terminal? Yes, as Dr. Nishita has said, it's conus medullaris because there's bilateral involvement. So bilateral involvement causes early involvement. In whereas caudae equina syndrome, initial unilateral, we have loss of perianal sensations, unilateral sign. As the injury increases and become bilateral, bilateral perianal nerves are injured, then the patient presents with bowel and bladder involvement. So probably I'm very clear of the cervical enlargement, the lumbar enlargement, and the concept of conus, cauda, and phylum terminal. We'll revisit the phylum because it's very important for us, particularly for physiotherapists and pediatricians and people who deal with spina bifida, cerebral palsy. This concept of phylum, conus, and cauda equina is very important. We'll come there again in this presentation. Okay. Let's go to the next concept. And now we will explore the cross section of the spinal cord. When you take a cross section of the brain, what do you have? We have the white matter and the gray matter. We have the similar things over here. This is the cross section of the spinal cord. This is the posterior or the dorsal aspect. This is the anterior aspect. And when you have taken a cross section, just like the brain, we have the gray matter, which is situated in the center. And the white matter, which is situated in the outside. So this one is the gray matter. I have indicated by writing G. This is the white matter. But how is it different from the brain? Brain has an inner gray matter nuclei in the form of basal ganglia, an overlying layer of white matter. And over the white matter, we have the cortical mantle, which is again gray matter. So inside of the brain is gray matter in the form of nuclei. In between you have the white matter, and outside with the cortex, which has the gray matter. So we have the white matter sandwiched between two layers of gray matter. But in spinal cord, we have the outer thick mantle of white matter and an inner gray matter. We don't have a cortex in the spinal cord. But so we have the gray matter, we have the white matter outside, and we have the spinal nerves coming out. So all these are the rootlets of the spinal nerve. A number of rootlets unite to become one spinal nerve. These are the, we have the rootlets, we have the roots, which are becoming the spinal nerve. So this is the individual rootlet, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we have the individual rootlets, which you unite to become the spinal root. We have this two spinal roots. This is the posterior spinal root. This is the anterior spinal root. Both of them unite to form the spinal nerve. Okay. One thing which every one of you know, and the basic. So which root is motor, which root is sensory? Dr. Kishan Sahu is asking what is conus cauda syndrome. I will come in the next webinar. Next webinar is all dealing with various syndromes. So in that part, we'll discuss in detail the syndrome. This is important because this is clinical important. Unless and until you apply your spinal anatomy concepts for clinical thing, learning anatomy doesn't make any important. So anterior, Dr. Nishita has told, the anterior root is the motor and posterior is the sensory. So this is our the sensory nerve root. This is our ventral or the anterior nerve root. All the rootlets forming the anterior nerve root are the motor nerve root, uniting with the posterior nerve root forming the spinal nerve. So I think the concept of rootlets, root, and the spinal nerve is clear. So from a spinal segment, how many rootlets are seen? One rootlet, Two rootlets are many. Today I'm very really happy because many of you are actively getting engaged. Unless you get actively engaged, you will not remember anything. So whatever you know, whether it's right or wrong, try to answer in the chat. So my question is, for a spinal segment, how many rootlets are seen? Is it a one rootlet, two rootlet, or many? Right, there are many rootlets. So second one, for a spinal segment, how many roots are seen? We have one root, two roots, or many roots? Rootlets are many. Roots are how many? Dr. Sirisha has answered many, but I'm not very sure for which answer has she answered. My question is, we have many rootlets for one segment. Right. As Dr. Sirisha has said, two roots are there for one spinal segment. We have the anterior spinal nerve root, which is motor, and the posterior root, which is sensory. So how many spinal nerves are there per segment? Right. So we have one spinal nerve. So one segment of spinal cord has one spinal nerve, two nerve roots, and many rootlets. And what of the two spinal roots, the anterior root and the posterior root, one root has a swelling. This is the ganglion. So this ganglion is located on the anterior nerve root or the posterior nerve root. So I'm showing it. This is a bulbous ending. This contains the ganglion. This contains the nerve cell bodies of which nerve root? Anterior or posterior? Posterior. So what do you call this one? We call that one the dorsal root ganglion. So we call that one dorsal root ganglion. Okay. Yeah. Now, first clinical syndrome. Have intraoperatively or because of some spinal cord injury, have cut two rootlets of this nerve. Let me indicate in red color. In color red. Okay. So I've injured this portion. So what will be the clinical symptom? Option one, there'll be complete loss of power in that segment. Second one, there'll be some loss of power in that segment. Third one, there'll be complete motor and sensory loss corresponding to that segment. Option four, there'll be complete sensory loss in that segment. So what will be the answer? So this is the lesion number one. So if I have an injury at this level, what will be the clinical manifestations for that patient? So option one was complete motor loss in that segment. Option two was partial motor loss. Option three was complete motor and sensory loss. Option four was only sensory loss. Dr. Madan was saying option four, which is complete motor and sensory loss. Why should it be there? No. See this one. I've injured only one or two rootlets. The entire other rootlets are there. So Dr. Stravan is saying only sensory loss, but here the sensory root is intact. We have the sensory root which is intact, so there will not be any sensory loss. There will not be complete loss because there are still some rootlets which are working. Yeah, Dr. Sahu has said option A, which is partial motor loss. Dr. Nishita is saying only motor loss, but you didn't say it whether it's partial or complete. Right, now everyone is right. So when there is injury to one or two or three rootlets, there is a partial motor loss which is proportionate to amount of rootlets injured. So intraoperative sometimes we wantedly injure. Suppose there is a tumor arising from one or two rootlets, we purposely cut these rootlets so that we get a complete tumor excision. Fine. Suppose there is an injury to the dorsal column. What will happen? Motor loss, there will be loss of power in that segment. There's loss of same. You can take the same thing. So there will be sensory loss. I accept. Someone is saying loss of fine touch and perception. No, there will be complete sensory loss because all the sensations will have to come through the, whether it's posterior column sensations corresponding to vibration or something, or the spine touch, all of them have to go through the posterior nerve root. So there'll be complete sensory loss in that segment. Similarly, if I injure this motor nerve root, so what will be the complaints? I have injured the motor root completely. So there'll be complete motor loss. So I think I'm very clear already. Next one, in my next session, I'll be dealing you with important tracts in the spinal cord and the brain. Actually, that session is more important than the present session, because unless you understand my next session, you'll not be able to understand the clinical syndromes. Just like what you were able to tell, partial motor loss, complete motor loss, complete sensory loss. Similarly, when I tell you about the tracts in detail, you will be able to understand clear. In this session, I'm not going to touch the tracts because it will get more complicated. And if it gets more complicated, you will just leave this session. So of all these motor tracts, first you answer me three things. Which tract is mainly involved with the motor power? Of all the motor tracts, which tract is involved with the motor power? I am concerned with three important tracts: the pyramidal tracts, the spinothalamic tracts, and the dorsal column, which is the fasciculus gracilis and the fasciculus cuneatus. So of these three motor tracts, of all these three important tracts, tell me the tract which is concerned with your power, fine motor movements. Pyramidal tracts, A. Spinothalamic tract, B. The dorsal column tract, that is fasciculus gracilis and cuneatus, which is C. The motor tracts is I'm waiting for these three answers. No, spinothalamic tract is not concerned with motor function. Can anyone tell the correct answer? Lateral spinothalamic is not. Pyramidal tracts, Dr. Priyanka has told, Dr. Fatima has told, everyone else is told. Dr. Stravin has told spinothalamic, which is wrong. This is the basic concept. Pyramidal tracts are the corticospinal tracts. They are concerned with the motor function. So the corticospinal tracts are the pyramidal tracts are concerned with the, so the pyramidal tracts. Okay, today I don't have a pen or a mouse, so bear with me. So the pyramidal tracts are concerned with the motor function. So let's come to second question. Now, obviously the remaining tracts are concerned with sensory. So one tract is concerned with crude touch, pain, and temperature. So which is the track which is concerned with the crude touch? So crude touch. So crude touch, pain, and temperature. So which tract is involved? So is it spinothalamic tract or the dorsal column tracts? Dr. Nishita, Dr. Shravani, anyone else? They have answered as spinothalamic tract. Spinothalamic tract, fine. So either it's the ventral spinothalamic tract or the lateral spinothalamic tract. They are concerned with crude, touch, pain, and temperature. So finally, can everyone answer me? What is the function of the dorsal column? So the dorsal white column, that is fasciculus cuneatus and fasciculus gracilis. Yeah, come to next question. So what is the function of dorsal columns? That is fasciculus gracilis and the fasciculus cuneatus. Right, proprioception. Any other function? Dr. Ramanandan has said proprioception, vibration, discriminatory touch, fine touch. So this is very clear. So before I tell you about the tract, when you see a spinal cord, it is divided into two parts, left and right, by the anterior median septum and the anterior median fissure and the posterior septum. We have the right and the left. Each part has two fissures, the posterolateral sulcus, see my cursor, and the anterolateral sulcus. So this is the posterolateral sulcus and this is the anterolateral sulcus. From the posterolateral sulcus, we have the rootlets of the dorsal nerve root. They unite to become the dorsal nerve. Similarly, from the anterolateral sulcus, we have the rootlets of the anterior nerve root. So because of this one, two sulci, the each half of the spinal cord is divided into three segments. Okay, am I clear? So this is this one. So if you join the central canal to the anterolateral sulcus and the central canal to the posterolateral sulcus, each half is divided into three segments. This is known as the dorsal horn. This is the lateral. And this is the ventral. Okay, now it's very important. So the dorsal part of the spinal cord. So the dorsal part, the white, the I will tell you that you take a cross section. There's gray matter and the white matter. So the white matter is divided into three funiculi: the dorsal columns, the lateral column, and the ventral column. So the dorsal column contains which tracts? And so the dorsal column contains which tract? And so the dorsal column is concerned with which function? I'm waiting for the answer. I will not hurry up. These concepts are very important, so I will be slow. Everyone, try to. Pyramidal is wrong. Dr. Ashwini has answered pyramidal, which is wrong. See, this is a dorsal column. So the dorsal column, the dorsal component contains a dorsal column, and the function of the dorsal column is fine touch, vibration, and position. Okay, one more. Before I ask you the next question, as everyone answered, the pyramidal tracts are the corticospinal tract. There are two things, of the lateral corticospinal tract and the ventral corticospinal tract. Similarly, the spinothalamic tract also has lateral spinothalamic tract and the ventral spinothalamic tract. So now with this hint, try to answer. So the lateral funiculi contains which tract among these three? So I have given a hint. Corticospinal tract is divided into two components, lateral and ventral. Similarly, spinothalamic tract is divided into two components, lateral and ventral. Now tell me, the lateral funiculus contains which tract among these three? Pyramidal? Why only lateral spinothalamic? As Priyanka, Dr. Priyanka, try to understand. You have the lateral spinothalamic tract and also lateral corticospinal tract. So the lateral funiculus contains two important tracts, spinothalamic and the corticospinal or the pyramidal tract. Similarly, the ventral funiculus also has the same two tracts. We have the spinothalamic and the pyramidal tracts. So when you come to a functional unit, the dorsal funiculus acts as one functional unit. So when there is an injury selective to the dorsal funiculus, what will be the clinical manifestations? If you have understood, I will proceed further, or you are free to ask your doubts here. So as I've told you, the dorsal funiculus contains only one tract. That is a dorsal column. So injury to the dorsal funiculus causes only loss of proprioception, vibration, and the fine touch. Whereas both the lateral funiculus and the anterior funiculus contain two tracts, that is pyramidal and the fine touch. So when there is injury to the ventral, actually you can say there are functionally two units, the dorsal funiculus and the, we call that one ventrolateral funiculus, or the dorsal funiculus and the anterolateral funiculus. So when there is injury to the anterolateral funiculus or the anterior funiculus or the lateral funiculus, we have the same clinical symptoms, that is there is motor weakness and also loss of crude touch, pain and temperature. Am I clear? So when you come to funiculi, we call them dorsal funiculus and anterolateral funiculus. So antero and lateral, they are combined into a single functional unit because they contain the same tracts. Coming to this one, this is quite easy. What are the coverings of the spinal cord? So just like a brain, we have the paramatter, overlying of the arachnoid matter and the dura matter. Just see the cross section. We have the dura matter, which is closely opposed to the vertebral column. We have the paramatter, which is closely opposed to the spinal cord. And between the two layers of the arachnoid matter. So this blue color is the CSF. So this CSF is there in which space? Subarachnoid space or the subdural space? So Dr. Gurpreet is asking me to repeat once again. So this is quite confusing. Okay, I have told you. Let me see. There are so many tracts in the spinal cord, but you are concerned only with three tracts, three important tracts. One is the pyramidal tracts, which are motor in function. We have the spinothalamic tract, which is concerned with crude touch, pain, and temperature. We have the dorsal columns, which are concerned with fine touch, vibration, and proprioception. When you see the funiculi, the dorsal funiculus has only one tract, that is the dorsal column, whereas both the ventral and the lateral funiculi, they contain both the tracts, because each tract is splits into two components. The corticospinal tract or pyramidal tract splits into lateral corticospinal tract, which you can see over here, and the ventral corticospinal tract. So a part of the pyramidal tract passes through the lateral funiculus and a part passes through the ventral funiculus. So Similarly, a part of the spinothalamic passes through the lateral funiculus and a part passes through the ventral funiculus. So when there's injury to the lateral funiculus or the ventral funiculus or the anterolateral funiculus, you are going to injure both these tracts, that is the corticospinal and the spinothalamic. So basically, when you come functionally, we say dorsal funiculus because it contains only one tract, and we call the anterolateral funiculus because it contains both the funiculi contain both the remaining two tracts. So when there is injury to the anterolateral funiculi, you have injury to the pyramidal tracts and the spinothalamic tract. So hope Dr. Gurpreet, if you have understood, try to reply saying yes, you have understood. So this concept of next question, the subarachnoid space, everyone has answered right. So when I put a lumbar puncture, I aspirate CSF from which space? Yeah, Dr. Gurpreet understood, so we'll go to the next one. So the same thing, the arachnoid matter and dura matter, arachnoid and paramatter. But you see, the paramatter gets condensed, thickened to form triangular structures. This structure connects the spinal cord to the bone. These are like hangings. These are connection between spinal cord, but these are called the denticulate ligaments. These are important for a surgeon, but not very clinically important for a physician or a neurophysician or a physiotherapist. So I will not go much into it. You can just remember denticulate ligaments are thickened, triangular shape, paramatter things, structures from paramatter, which connects the spinal cord and hangs the spinal cord within the vertebral column. And hope I am clear with the concept of one. See, all these rootlets, they are getting united to form one dorsal root. So this is one root, and this all this forms one spinal segment. Okay, so this entire thing one forms one spinal segment. I'm stressing this one more. I'm stressing this because this segment, this concept of segment is useful for us later on. Fine. This ascent of spinal cord. What is ascent of spinal cord? Why is it is important? I will teach. I will go to next one. Okay. I thought I would please. So I will explain you what is ascent of spinal cord. Here I will use some my own diagrams. Try to bear with me. This red one which I'm drawing is the vertebral column. Once I explain this concept of ascent of spinal cord, unless every one of your answers in yes, I will not go to the next slide. This is very important because this concept is important for you to understand the concept of spina bifida, myelo, meningocele, cerebral palsy, tether cord syndrome, annual cali malformation, many things. And all these things are clinically important for a surgeon, for a neurophysician, for a general physician, for a physiotherapist, for everyone who are dealing with this kind of patient. So understand, and when I complete, I want each one of you to answer me in affirmation. So the red one which I've drawn is the vertebral column. Okay, now I will draw brain in blue color. Okay, so this is the brain and this is the spinal cord. Okay, within the vertebral column, we have our spinal cord. This is the thing which is seen in the fetus. That is in our mother's womb. What I wanted to tell is, in the mother's womb, the length of the spinal cord is equivalent to the length of the vertebral column. But as the fetus grows in the mother, as it becomes 3 months old, 6 months old, 9 months old, what happens is red color is the vertebral column. So what happens is the vertebral column grows very rapidly. Why? Because bone grows, bone and muscles, they grow very rapidly. Whereas even the spinal cord grows, but the rate of growth of this spinal cord is slow compared to the rate of growth of the vertebral column. So what happens? So as I've told you, blue is the our brain and the spinal cord. So the brain has grown, spinal cord has also grown. Is my voice not clear? Is it the same for everyone? If anyone else says my voice is not clear, I will try to look into it. So the spinal cord has also grown in length, but the rate of the growth of spinal cord is less. So what happens by the time the fetus is born, the length of this vertebral column is far more than the length of the spinal cord. So it essentially means the spinal cord, which was reaching the coccyx in the first 3 months of pregnancy, by the time it's born, it doesn't reach the coccyx. It ends somewhere at the level of lumbar region. It ends in the lumbar region. So is it clear? In the fetus, the spinal cord is equal in length to the vertebral column. So the spinal cord reaches the level of the coccyx. Whereas by the time the fetus is born, it has reached 9 months. The length of the vertebral column is more compared to length of the spinal cord. So the spinal cord doesn't reach the tip of the coccyx. So the spinal cord doesn't reach the coccyx. It ascends up. It reaches only the lumbar level. In majority of the cases, it ends between L1 and L2. In some fetus, it may stay at the level of L3, which is also normal. But anything below the L3 at the time of birth is abnormal. So similarly, as I've told you, bone and muscles rapidly grow in their length. Fibrous tissue also grows in the length, but the nervous tissue grows in the length, but slowly. So what happens, the overlying pia arachnoid matter, also they grow in this level. So they reach up till the coccyx. But this part between the conus and the coccyx has only pia arachnoid member. So this forms the phylum terminare. So this forms the phylum. So this forms phylum. So is this concept clear? Why there is ascent of the spinal cord? Why the phylum terminal is formed? Why the phylum terminal does not contain neural tissue? For this concept of ascent of spinal cord, I want an yes from majority of you, because on this only my next concept are built up. Yeah, so because everyone has answered yes, suppose I tell you this phylum, because of some abnormality, is thickened, has become fibrous, has become fatty. So it has become thick, it has become taut. So what happens? So the phylum terminal is thickened. So what happens? It causes one pathological condition. So what is it? So this thick end phylum terminal will pull the spinal cord down. Will pull the spinal cord down. So what do you call this condition? No. Spina bifida is a, you are nearby, but exact thing. Neurogenic bladder is a component of this, is a symptom of this condition. The thickened phylum pulls the spinal cord down, pulls the conus down. It tethers the spinal cord. So what do you call this syndrome of tethering by thickened phylum terminal? I'm giving a hint, we short form is TCS. Cauda equina syndrome is some of the symptoms of this syndrome. We call it tethered cord syndrome. Spina bifida, myelomeningocele, meningocele, all these are parts of tethered cord syndrome. Anything which prevents the ascent of spinal cord by causing adherence of this tip of nerve roots or the conus to the vertebral column is called tethered cord syndrome. So when there's a thickened phylum, it pulls the conus down. So the spinal cord in turn pulls the brain down into the foramen magnum. So what is this syndrome called? The herniation of the brainstem and the cerebellum through the foramen magnum into the vertebral column is called what? Which syndrome is it? Right. This is called Arnold-Chiari syndrome. This is called Arnold-Chiari syndrome, which is herniation of the tonsils. So this is a normal spinal cord and the vertebral column. So the normal spinal cord ends at the level of L1 and L2, between L1 and L2. If the spinal cord ends below the L1, L2, it is called tethered cord syndrome and it's an abnormality. So is it clear? So the conus ends over here at the level of L1 and L2, L1 and L2. Below this one, we have the non-neural tissue, which is the phylum terminal, which gets attached to the cortex. So this is the normal spine. At the L1 conus, in this case, the phylum has thickened. It has become fatty, so it has pulled this spinal cord from the L1 to boom because of thickened phylum terminal. So conus medialis L1, because of tethering, it has been pulled down, and this is again TCS, tethered cord syndrome, because of thickened phylum terminal. Now the concept of spinal segments. As I've told repeatedly, and I've also told you the concept of ascent of the spinal cord. So let's come over here. Suppose I punch at the level of D6. Okay, I'm injuring focal, I'm taking a hammer. Okay, I'm taking a hammer. Okay, I'm taking a hammer. Focally, I will injure at the level of spinous process of D, thoracic 6 vertebra. So, does it cause an injury at 6th spinal segment? Yes or no? I think now my voice should be clear again. So, what I mean to say is, opposite D6 vertebra, will I find D6 spinal segment? Yes or no? I think I'm audible again. Dr. Madan, am I audible? Okay, so answer this question first. We will go step by step. Suppose I injured D6. I count D6 spinous process, take a hammer and hit on it. So which segment of spinal cord will I injure? Just say yes or no. Am I going to injure D6 spinal segment? Yes or no? Dr. Nishita said D7. That's the right answer. Can Dr. Nishita explain why not D7? Explain it. Why not D6? Yeah, everyone knows it's not D6. So can anyone tell which segment will I injure? D7. Why? So why am I not injuring D6? So D6 is present above D6 vertebra or below D6 vertebra? Yeah, everyone answer is partially right. D6 is right. It will not injure D6. D6 spinal segment is present above the D6, but D7 is a wrong answer. Why? So this is the calculation. Above is the right answer, but it's not D6, but you are going to injure D8 spinal segment. So how do you remember it? In the cervical region, you add 1. So you have to remember 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. In cervical region, you will add 1 segment. In upper dorsal, D1 to D6, you will add 2. In lower dorsal, that is D7, D8, D9, D10, you will add 3. D11, add 4. D12, just remember L5 and D1, all the remaining segments. So quickly, so is it easy? 1, 2, 3, 4, cervical 1, upper dorsal 2, lower dorsal 3, D11, 4. One thing which you have to remember, D12 is L5, D12 is L5. Just remember D12 is L5, remaining all is easy. So let me apply. Suppose I use my hammer and injure at C7, which segment is going to be injured? I'm hitting with my hammer at C7. Right. C8. A C7, I'll have to add only 1. There are 8 cervical nerves. So answer is C8, not D1. Suppose I hit a patient at L1 vertebra. So which nerve roots are going to be injured? All the sacral and coccygeal segments. Fine. And last two concepts I'm going to say, then wind off this session and again we'll go to the next session. Everyone knows this is a reflex arc. So we have the gray matter, we have the white matter and the reflex arc. So what does the gray matter contains? The gray matter contains the cell body of the nerve of the neuron. Okay, so any nerve involving this in reflex arc is known as a lower motor neuron. But so all this thing, this is the reflex arc. So all these nerve roots, so we have the anterior nerve root, we have the interneurons, we have the posterior nerve root, both of them from the spinal nerve. This entire thing is known as the lower motor neuron. And so what is upper motor neuron? The upper motor neurons are the tracts, are the nerve roots, nerve neurons, which are in this various tracts, which I've told you, the pyramidal tracts, the dorsal tract, the spinothalamic tracts, which come from the brain and influence this reflexa. So all this form the upper motor neuron. Okay. So what is the function of this upper motor neuron on the reflexa? Is it excitatory or inhibitory? Does the pyramidal tract excite? Does the pyramidal tract excite the reflex arc, or does it inhibit the reflex arc? Waiting for your answer. The pyramidal tracts, that is upper motor neurons, are they excitatory or inhibitory? Someone said, Dr. Shravani said inhibit, Dr. Priyanka said excite. So let me wait for more answers. Excitatory, and everyone is wrong. The function of the upper motor neuron is inhibitory. It's not excitatory. So the upper motor neurons inhibit the lower motor neuron. This is not one, this is I. So the upper motor neurons inhibit the reflex arc. So when there's injury to the upper motor neuron, the reflex arc overwards or underwards? See, understand, the upper motor neurons are inhibited to the pyramidal, to the reflex arc. Injury to the upper motor neuron, the pyramidal arc, the reflex arc, overwards or underwards? I will wait for your answers. And there is a delay of nearly 10 seconds between what I'm teaching and what you're hearing because of YouTube. So if I'm pausing in between, bear with me. So the answer is overwards. That is why in upper motor neuron lesions, the reflex arc overworks and the tone increases or decreases. Bear with my pauses because this is YouTube, which gives a 10 seconds gap. Yeah, so this is the basic component in lesions of UMN lesion. There is increase in tone, whereas in an LMN lesion, there is a decrease in tone. Okay, this image again we'll see in the next session when we'll be trying to localize the lesions and try to guess the clinical symptoms. Okay. Last concept which I want you to know, the blood supply of the spinal cord. The blood supply of the spinal cord, there is much to learn, but clinically two things you have to remember. The anterior part is supplied by the anterior spinal artery, which is centered in the midline. And the posterior one is supplied by the posterior spinal arteries, which are paired structures. But the anterior spinal artery, although single, it is large, it is big. It is large and it is big. So what is this implication? If you see this one, only the posterior columns, very small portion, only 1/3 of the spinal cord is supplied by the posterior spinal artery. Whereas 2/3 of the spinal cord, that is the anterolateral funiculi. I have told you the anterolateral funiculi are a functional single one. Similarly, the anterolateral funiculi are supplied by the ventral spinal artery. So 2/3 of the spinal cord is supplied by. So 2/3 of the spinal cord is supplied by the anterior spinal artery. Only the 1/3 is supplied by the posterior spinal artery. So, and this one I have told you, the anterolateral funiculi contain what and the posterior funiculi contain what. So the posterior funiculi are supplied by the posterior spinal artery. And the remaining things are supplied by the anterior spinal artery. So suppose there is an occlusion of the anterior spinal artery, it causes the anterior spinal syndrome. So the anterior spinal artery syndrome. So if the in the anterior spinal artery syndrome, which deficits do you see? This is my final clinic concept which I'm trying to teach you now. So anterior spinal artery, what are the clinical symptoms? Motor, loss of sensation and pain temperature. What happens to motor? Is it lost or spared? Sirisha Gupta said spared. Okay, let me change my question. Which function is spared in anterior spinal artery syndrome? They are lost. Three tracts, only one tract is spared. So which tract is spared in anterior spinal artery syndrome? Motor is wrong. So answer spared and the tract. Otherwise it's confusing to which one. I want which one is spared. So these white structures are spared. So what are these structures? Dr. Priyanka told dorsal funiculus is spared. So dorsal tracts are spared. So I'm waiting for others to answer the same thing. So it's very clear from the evidence. This entire 2/3 is supplied by the anterior spinal artery. So two tracts are involved, the corticospinal and the spinothalamic. So which tract is spared? Right. So dorsal tract, that is fasciculus cuneus and gracilis spared. So the patient has spared vibration and fine touch, but there is complete paralysis and there's complete loss of true touch pain and temperature. So probably I have complete, I'm clear. So do you have any, doubts now? If you have any doubts, I think if I teach more, if it's more complicated in my next session, I'll be teaching you these three important tracts, the dorsal column tracts, the pyramidal tracts, and the spinothalamic tracts. And the next session will be purely clinical. We'll be discussing various syndromes like the Brown-Séquard syndrome, anterior spinal artery syndrome, the syndrome because of vitamin B12 deficiency, syndromes of complete transection of the spinal cord, the conus medullary syndrome, the cauda equina syndrome, injury to the pyramidal tracts, and what are the symptoms which you see at each level, C6, C7, D1, D10, and all these things. So does anyone has any other doubts? Yeah, I don't see any doubts there. So I think I conclude this session for now. Thanks to everyone for actually participating. I think nearly every participant has participated in this one. I request you to spread this webinar, the information regarding webinar among your circles so that we can have a bigger group. My idea of combining the knowledge of a physiotherapist with a neurophysician and a neurosurgery. Let's hope it works out. And most important is, be safe. Thank you.